So how did you get into astronomy in the first place?
Well, when I was 14 years old, I saw an eclipse for the first time, and it was predicted, which was really interesting, and I found that predicting the stars would be a really neat thing. Fascinating.
In fact, Brahe began studying at the University of Copenhagen when he was 13, but things didn't start out well for him.
I got this Danish the other day at Jan Dirksen's, and it was pretty expensive. But
hi, I'm a 13-year-old super genius. I'm new to this university. Can you tell me where the astrophysics lab is?
I'll show you where the astrophysics lab is.
You just go straight down this way, okay?
Mm-hmm. You can turn left and then go a little straight.
Oh, thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome.
Oh, thanks.
Oh, by the way.
Oh yes.
Oh.
So anyway, you're saying about that Danish?
Oh, it was as delicious as Copenhagen is our capital.
My bladder hurts.
Despite having to adjust to new surroundings, Brahe persisted and found his inspiration.
You had two important discoveries. What were they?
The first one is what I call a nova, and you guys call a supernova. This has never been seen before. The importance of it was mostly philosophical. It proved that the heavens were immutable and unchanging, which is the central part of existing dogma. The second one that I observed was a comet. Again, it showed that a comet providing clear evidence that the heavens were not static and unchanging. I found that things could move through the heavenly realms without necessarily being fixed in distance or on some rotating crystalline sphere.
Despite personal success in his work, Brahe still had conflict in his life. While intoxicated one night, he got into a duel.
Hey, dude.
Yeah?
Did you ever think that maybe the Earthman following here, the Earth, might go around the sun, man?
No, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah,
I've looked at the,
stupid,
at the
I know.
Sky for years and
hey,
you know,
super genius.
What do you want?
What's going on, super genius? Looks like you're all grown up now.
Yeah.
I challenge you to a duel.
This is not the best timing.
The timing was indeed poor. He was drunk.
The name of the game. Trivia by the pound. Sudden death.
I'm so confident in my intellectual abilities that I will even gamble my nose.
It's on, Brahe.
Surely this man could save himself with a battle of wits. Or could he?
Read the question.
True or false? It is possible to die from an overtaxed bladder.
No way. That's false. Can I go to the washroom?
I'm sorry. Yeah. The answer is Dan Marino.
Ha! You lose!
The results were devastating. Brahe would be forced to wear a variation of gold, silver, and metal plates on his nose for the rest of his life.
It still hurts, even today.
Despite this tragedy, Brahe went on to make astronomical instruments such as the armillary sphere, and even begin to hatch his own philosophical beliefs. Brahe was also taking under his wing an assistant, the German Lutheran Johannes Kepler.
Well, hey, Johannes Kepler.
So? Hey, look, an undiscovered planet.
Oh, what the? That was my life's work.
Things got worse for Brahe. The worst came one night. At a banquet. After many drinks, his bladder was growing to a dangerous size. Still trying to keep his manners up, he remained polite and did not leave.
Well, that dinner was lovely. Thank you for inviting me over.
It was my pleasure, you know, and say, have you ever been to Niagara Falls?
Could you please not talk about that?
Why not?
I really gotta go.
Oh, I know what you mean. Don't worry about it. We'll be over soon, you know. Oh, Tycho, something's stuck in your mustache. I think you got it. Oh, Cedric, show me that trick you were talking about.
Being a gentleman, Brahe did not want to leave.
Why, yes, Charles. Phoenix does begin with the letter P.
Brahe was now in grave danger.
I don't mean to be rude.
Oh, no.
I gotta go.
Oh, what, where are you off to now, young man? Oh, if you know and...
Hey, Kel. Oh my God, one of the greatest astral legitimists is dead. Hey, Kepler! Kepler, come here.
What's up?
He beat himself, man. He's dead.
Oh, shit. We gotta get rid of the body. I don't know what to do.
You had a revolutionary philosophy. Tell me about it.
Well, it's really divided up into two sections. I was the first scientist to recognize the importance of making lots of observations to provide an enormous database of subsequent analysis. Night after night, I would carefully measure and tabulate the positions of the stars and planets. Some of my observations were later analyzed by Kepler, and it showed that the Ptolemaic system simply failed to reproduce what was actually going on. Without excellent and trustworthy observations to show up my inconsistencies, the discrepancies might have gone unnoticed for many decades. My second contribution was just as valuable. I strove to make precise measurements using the best equipment that I could devise. I had no telescope, so I was using what were called quadrant devices, which were long pivoting sticks which could be moved to allow observations of a star in transit. It was pretty good, considering I couldn't take pictures of the sky or anything.
Anything else you want to say about your legacy?
Well, I owned a dwarf and a tame moose, so I must be important.
Tycho, that's how you spell RC.